This is The Future Of, where experts share their vision of the future and how their work is helping shape it for the better.
I'm David Blaney. Many of us will know someone who has succumbed to liver cancer. It's one of the most rapidly growing causes of death worldwide. But unfortunately, by the time liver cancer is diagnosed, it's usually incurable, with current treatments prolonging life by only months. With me today to discuss the quest to cure liver disease and liver cancer is Associate Professor Nina Tirnitz-Parker, who heads the Liver Disease and Regeneration Group at Curtin University, and her research partner and the Director of Research Development at Fiona Stanley Hospital, Professor John Olynyk.
Morning.
To start with you, John, I guess a bit of background, what's the difference between liver cancer and liver disease?
So currently I work as the head of gastroenterology and hepatology at Fiona Stanley Hospital, and I've been working in the field of liver disease and gastroenterology for over 30 years now. Liver disease is very common and has been increasing in terms of its prevalence in the community and the knowledge that people in the community have about it for a long time. Liver disease basically just means your liver isn't working right for some reason. Many people with liver disease have absolutely no symptoms whatsoever. So they can be walking around feeling completely well and yet have a very scarred liver. Conversely, some people can feel very unwell with it. So there's a huge range of manifestations. So you don't have to look sick to have liver disease. The commonest causes of liver disease would be what we call non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. In other words, obesity-related liver disease. And that globally now is the most common liver disease. So it's, again, a lifestyle manifestation of obesity and weight gain.
Is it just because we're living longer that we, you know, we tended to sort of get cleaned up by these sorts of diseases which we wouldn't have got younger? Or is it due to our lifestyle?
Combination of both. So we are living longer, yes, and so we're living long enough for whatever nasty things we take into our bodies or do to our bodies to have some sequelae. But also there's a lot of other factors driving these things. So it's not just what we eat and watching too much TV. It's genetics, it's what our parents have done, the effect that that's had on us as we're developing, and then it's all the exposures after we're born, be it diet, lifestyle, that ultimately manifest as this. And so for fatty liver disease, it's a combination of all of the above. The treatment, therefore, is not any one individual thing. It has to cut across the board of all the things that contribute to it. And then if you have liver disease long enough, the liver is quite an intelligent organ. It tries to fix itself. And in the process of fixing itself, ultimately, at some point, it may get it wrong. And that's when we end up with cancer as a complication of that process.
Why does it take so long for us to detect liver cancer?
Because, again, the liver disease itself, which is a requirement, can be very subtle and have no symptoms. And then the cancer itself, just in the same way as, for example, breast cancer. You may only realize you've got breast cancer if you find a lump. It's not because you felt unwell or looked any different until it's very late in the disease. Same with bowel cancer. That's why we have screening for it, because we know symptoms are not a very good way of diagnosing it. And so in the community, walking around, people won't expect that they've got liver cancer, especially in the early, most treatable sorts of phases. It's only they'll look unwell when it's very advanced, and by then we've lost the battle.
And we don't usually screen people for liver cancer in the same way that we do for bowel cancer or for breast cancer, is that right?
In a general sense in the community, no. But if we know that you have chronic liver disease and you've got what we call cirrhosis or advanced scarring of the liver, then we will recommend people to have an ultrasound every 6 months and possibly some blood tests as well to keep an eye on the liver to detect the earlier stages of something going wrong in the form of a cancer.
Nina, you're quite heavily involved in research in this space. I understand you recently got an NHMRC grant to do some research. What's it about?
I did, and John Olynyk is also part of that. It's an international collaboration we have with the Centre for Regenerative Medicine in Edinburgh, in Scotland, and QIMR Burghofer in Brisbane. And it's looking at two forms of liver cancer. One is hepatocellular carcinoma, the most common form, especially in Australia. And the other one is cholangiocarcinoma, or cancer of the bile ducts. And our research looks at how we can target certain cells in that process of liver disease and tell them to induce regeneration as opposed to liver disease progression to cancer. So we want to understand how these cells talk to each other. We want to decode their language and pretty much make them do what we want them to do. The project itself focuses on a certain pathway that we discovered to play a major role in liver disease progression. And we want to find ways to actually inhibit that sort of language that the cells use to talk to each other. So there are some certain ways we want to develop what's called small molecule inhibitors. There are certain ways like antibodies where you can target certain cells and block their activity, if you like. And we've taken it to a step where we are almost in a phase one clinical trial phase. So we want to establish the foundation for the research to take that pretty much from bench to bedside. So that's the pipeline.
And that would involve some sort of pharmaceutical treatment, or how would
eventually
that...
Yes, so we are not there yet. We need to first establish the mechanisms. We really need to understand what's going on before we risk the health of a patient. So there are certain steps that we need to do first. We look at cells in isolation where we know exactly what's going on. Then we need to test what we think has an effect in a bigger system. So we look into, let's say, something called precision organ slices, where we can have little organ systems and we can look at the cells in their natural environment without risking the health of a patient. So it's actually possible to take a little piece of liver, slice it into many different mini organ systems. In the mini organ systems, we can test different ranges of drugs, different combinations, different concentrations, and determine what really made the best effect without any side effects. So we can test this outside the body before we have to risk the health of a patient, which is quite exciting, a very powerful technique.
So what's on the horizon with respect to research in liver disease? What do we need to learn?
So John and I work together as a clinical and sort of fundamental research team because we actually look at those things. So what is most important to work on? What would make the best difference, the biggest difference for a patient? And at the moment, we pretty much work towards prevention is better than cure. So we would like to identify, let's say, biomarkers, which is molecules that we can identify in the blood of a patient or in the tissue. So say you go to the doctor, you have a blood sample taken, and we would like to take that sample and look at sort of the signature of molecules that are in there, sort of a fingerprint of that patient, and say, does that tell us whether a patient will develop liver cancer or do they need to be put in a higher surveillance group? What can we actually predict from that sort of signature? We also need to identify all the mechanisms better, how it actually develops, so not only what predicts it, but identify pathways that we can interfere with. And at the moment, we are in a very exciting time in liver cancer research because a lot of technologies have just become available. For example, previously, you could look at sequencing, which means you decode the language of cells, so how the genes are transcribed, and you could only do that for whole tissue pieces. And just very recently, the technique was developed to actually look at this in a much higher resolution. So you can look at a single cell level. And we are involved in a few projects in collaboration with the Harry Perkins Institute for Medical Research. And we are actually looking at the profile of individual cells and how they talk to other cells and how we can target those cells. And we identify new cell populations every day in our analysis, and it's a really exciting time.
John, treatment options right now for liver cancer and chronic liver disease are relatively limited. Why are these options limited?
Okay, so if you look at it, it depends again who you're talking about. So if you're talking about a population, the sorts of treatments we do at a population level are by necessity very different to what an individual patient gets because of cost, availability and things. So treatments need to be designed to layer into all levels of society. So out there in the community for liver disease, probably the most effective strategies are those related to the lifestyle inducing elements of this. So obesity and weight, things designed to treat that. Alcohol, exposure to chronic viral hepatitis, and everything from needle control to not using drugs or sharing needles, etc. So they're all the things at a community level. Once you get to a patient, the diseases we can treat fairly effectively now are chronic viral hepatitis, where we've got good drugs for both hepatitis B and hepatitis C. So in hepatitis C, it's curable, and hepatitis B, it's controllable. However, once you turn up with alcohol-related liver disease or non-alcoholic fatty liver disease to the point where you're presenting to a hospital and unwell, there's very little we can do. We do try and get people to stop alcohol, and we have programs with that, but often that's easier said than done. Fatty liver disease, the same sort of thing happens. So we'll often end up seeing people who've just incubated whatever disease process is going on all their lives and then turn up with a clinical problem. Either they're unwell, they look unwell, they've got a complication of chronic liver disease, or they've got liver cancer. And once you get cancer, the problem is that for most people, they've got a degree of severe scarring or impairment of the way the liver works anyway. So, and as you, most people know, if you have liver disease or kidney disease or heart disease, it dramatically impedes the ability to take drugs which could kill cancer cells and use them safely. So that's the first thing in patients with liver disease. You can't use nasty drugs because the liver can't clear them properly, and you'll end up harming the patient rather than the cancer. So chemo is very limited. There are new drugs coming along, but to be honest, they're more in a palliating, life-extending mode rather than a curative mode. Cures for liver cancer, that is, we found the abnormality, can remove it. Less than 10 to 20% of people are in a curative mode. So the majority of people who will turn up now with the world's second commonest cancer that causes years of life lost will be going into, we're going to try and extend their life and quality of life rather than cure them type mode. So that's why, if you think about it, by 2030, of all the people in the world with chronic liver disease, the majority of them, when they die because of their chronic liver disease, will die because of liver cancer, not because of their liver just failing and not working. So there's going to be a dramatic change in the way we as a community experience and see liver disease over the next 10 to 20 years.
How are we doing in terms of population health in this area? I understand, personally, I was vaccinated against Hep A and Hep B under the childhood vaccination program. How are things trending? Are we getting better in this area, or are we getting less and less healthy?
So viral hepatitis, hepatitis B, universal vaccination, that's a standard of care, just as it is for many viruses, and it's a preventable disease. So everything we do that can prevent something is well worth doing. There's good data on that. Alcohol, again, it's an issue in our community. It is globally, and unfortunately, no matter what we tend to do, we will always see and experience alcohol-related liver disease. Nutrition, and the fatty liver disease, which is now the commonest, that starts almost after birth. It's not the problem just of the person who's got it in adult life. It actually incubates during whenever mothers are pregnant with their children, because there's genetic and other lifestyle things that contribute to the risk. There's early life nutrition. So, for example, if you're breastfed for the first 6 months of life, without introducing solid foods, you have a much lower risk of fatty liver disease and, in fact, a lot of other metabolic things. So there's a whole raft of things. And then we get to the people like me who work in a hospital who see that pointy tip of an iceberg of people who come in. We'd rather not be seeing that, and that's where Nina's research comes in, to try and prevent this whole cascade going wrong, because the reason we live with liver disease is our liver can repair itself. And so we just need to get the balance right where the good stuff happens, i.e. the liver fixes itself and keeps us healthy as long as we can, but try and avoid the bad sequelae, which is the cancer development, which is really getting the language right between the cells, which is where Nina's targeting all that work.
Nina, could you tell us about the Lions Lotus PhD Scholarship?
We received very generous support from the Lions Cancer Institute. They were interested in supporting a PhD scholarship scheme. That's not the first one that they've supported. They've teamed up with the Cancer Council of Western Australia, and two Curtin University students received top-up scholarships this year already, working on different areas of cancer research. So one is in cancer and palliative care, and the other one is an immunologist. So different aspects of cancer research are supported. And I approached them with an idea earlier this year to see how we can possibly attract the best student to cover 3.5 years of PhD studies, just to kickstart that scheme. But we plan for the student to get a government-funded scholarship, because we will only select the best student possible that already has the runs on the board to really be competitive for those government scholarships. And then we only take 10,000 out of that pot instead of 30,000. So if I can fill that gap on a yearly basis with my fundraising, then we can make it an in perpetuity scheme, which would be exciting because then you don't have to plan for 3.5 years. You can really look at the big ticket items and say, what can we do within 10 years of our research? How can we drive this and really have a meaningful, impactful change in the research field? So I'm currently fundraising around a trip coming up to Antarctica to fill that yearly gap of 10,000 so we can make it an in perpetuity scheme.
What are you doing in Antarctica?
That is part of a program called Homeward Bound. It's an international leadership program for women in STEM. So STEM stands for science, technology, engineering, maths, and medicine. And I guess I represent science and medicine. It's a program that was designed by an Australian group, actually, but now it's global. And it's supposed to equip 1,000 women over 10 years with skills and a louder voice to fight for what is close to their heart and to inform policy and come up with strategies that secure a positive future for our planet, basically. So there's very different aspects that go into that program. So there's people from space shuttle engineer to conservationists to medical researchers. And the Antarctica trip is a retreat. So what's better than a retreat in Antarctica? I guess we can focus for 4 weeks on what is important. We can collaborate and we have scientific programs. And around that trip, there's a lot of media attention because it's an all-female expedition. I'm in the fourth cohort with actually 6 other people from Perth. 2 other Curtin people are in the cohort. And around the trip, I'll fundraise for the Lions Lotus PhD Scholarship, but also for the PNE Scholarship, which is a scholarship scheme focused on pancreatic cancer research, because that's something that's also close to my heart. So if anyone is interested to support this, they can contact Curtin University, and the Curtin Foundation will look after those funds and make sure that they go directly to our research and support those students that work in our research program.
And if there's anyone listening, anyone who knows a smart student or themselves, or if they themselves reckon they're pretty switched on,
sure.
What should they do if they're interested in
it? It will be
more
advertised very soon on the Curtin University website. I think it is already advertised, but you can't yet apply for it because I planned to set it up first, get it known out there, to be able to really select from a big pool of students. So we are advertising very soon. I think the first student will be able to start in 2020 or 2021. We will not just throw the money away. We are really waiting for top people to come along that are enthusiastic and want to make a big difference. And the PNE scholarship will be set up around the same time. So whether they're interested in liver cancer research or pancreatic cancer research, there's some exciting things happening at Curtin.
Well, I think that's a very good place to wrap up this discussion. Thank you very much, Nina and John, for sharing your insights, and all the best for your research and for your trip to Antarctica.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah.
And that brings us to the end of this episode. You've been listening to The Future Of, a podcast powered by Curtin University. If you have any questions about today's topic, please feel free to get in touch by following the links in the show notes. Bye for now.